Hey, good afternoon, Manchester, New Hampshire. We are waiting for our guest to arrive. We know he's here. He's got to use a little muscles. Coming up the stairs. Probably the elevator. I'm lazy. I should use the stairs more.
We both should be. But the wind made that door hard to open. That,
it does. And I don't want to ruin my makeup trying to open that door. That's ridiculous, Oh, Lord, help us. I told her, be prepared for a lot of laughs. We got a nice little lady out there doing the camera.
Yeah, yeah.
I have had the pleasure of doing a show with Mary. She does a camera.
Yes,
she does
that's
really
right.
Good job. God, you know how hard it hurts me to be
I know.
Nice?
It's tough for you to be nice. It's a strain. Oh.
It really is. It almost gets the heart fibrillation. I have this lady, of course, I don't remember how to pronounce her last name. She's in the hospital, and she's in the catheter, and her kidneys are really going kaput, And I'm trying to get it to get her back onto the kidney machine. Wait a minute, I can look it up. So they can go. I'm not a fan of dialysis with people. I've seen too many people that had the dialysis, and like my friend Bob. He had the dialysis, and next you know.
Well, it helps some. It doesn't help everybody. Yeah. But, as a nurse, I'm sure you saw more people than most people see.
Yeah. Hey, he made it. Yay.
Yes.
Brought right over here. And, and I've seen, and like you said, I've seen it help people. But the sad part is when they start helping people, they go overboard with it, or you know what I mean? Then they... People, like I know, people get shots because they're diabetic. Oh, I could have a candy bar. So then they take the shot, and then they go. Then they wonder why they're sick all the time. I was just talking about my friend who's on the kidney machine right now. Well, I'd like to welcome if you'll introduce you. Pull your chair right up and introduce yourself.
Hey, my name's Shea Burke.
And you started an organization. Pull the mic right up to you. Don't be shy. You never shy in my office.
Oh, I just don't know what I'm doing.
Now, you were in the military.
Yep, U.S. Marine Corps.
Yeah, and then you also now are starting a new program, am I correct?
We are. So being in the military, serving overseas in Afghanistan with the Marine Infantry, we did our duty, we did our part overseas, worked as a team. We're able to come home as an entire unit after receiving 25% of our unit received Purple Hearts. But thankfully, we didn't receive any casualties directly in my company. The majority of the casualties were in Charlie and weapons companies from IEDs. So coming home, we're dealing with a lot of veterans who, my friends, comrades, fellow Marines, who haven't quite adjusted or readjusted back to society. And unfortunately, these, I believe, are the guys who, they're the helpers. They're not the ones who want to ask for help. So it takes a lot to bring them back into the community and the community they want to be brought back into, which I believe is the veterans community. So what we're looking to do is establish a revenue-generating nonprofit that employs veterans. So it's along the lines of, let's say, Goodwill. So they receive donations such as clothing, and then they sell it, generating revenue. And then they're able to give it back to their great causes. So we already have our 501c3 verification, which I did myself. I did all the planning for it. I did all the paperwork after studying at Norwich University for pre-law. It took 6 months, but without any lawyers, we were able to file the 114 pages of paperwork to the IRS and get them verified. And our entire goal is to receive organic donations such as grass clippings, wood chips, anything of that nature, receive them, and transform them into things like bark mulch, firewood, loam for your yard, and just grow and build upon that, developing a veterans community.
Interesting. So, I have a bunch of brush in my backyard. You would take that and make it into wood chips?
We would. We would take it, we would grind it down, and then we would turn it into bark mulch.
Cool. We'll talk.
Yeah. So we can get it out of there. But our goal is to
set a flyer or a paperwork.
Or a name.
Or a name
of the group.
It's called Dirt for Veterans.
I forgot my flyer, too. I told you to bring one.
We handed out all of our flyers. So on all social media, it's at Dirt Veterans.
Okay.
Just phonetically.
That's your website?
Website, all social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Venmo, everything. So we We're over all social media, so you start
I've known Shane for about 5 or 6 years now, maybe 7 years. I remember when he was
a student, since
high school.
Yeah.
So, a long time ago. His mother is an awesome lady as well. You know.
Yeah, and, she's a teacher in Manchester.
Yeah, you know.
So, so you said there's a group of you. How many? You know, how many of you are there?
So there's five. how many are there?
How many is a group?
There's a lot.
But I mean, to start it out, I mean, how many, like a board member? You have to have a board member,
we,
right?
We do. So you need to give up ownership over the entity because it's a nonprofit. So its governance is in the form of a board. Thankfully, I have great friends who are all industry experts or have studied it at University of New Hampshire, like accounting, finance. So we have the roles filled by my good friends from high school that are now experts within their own fields. We have an arborist.
Isn't that amazing?
It is. Yeah. We have an arborist. We have a heavy equipment operator. We have a finance major who went to UNH. Then we also have the former head of logistics for Gillette out of Massachusetts, who I studied at Norwich with. So they're all individually successful in their own rights. And now, thankfully, we're able to come together as a group with no sense of greed, more of a sense of purpose to develop this idea.
Do you find you're getting a lot of notice from the people that are showing interest? Because
we are.
I truly believe that whether you're homeless, whether you're a vet, homeless vet, or you're a homeless period or whatever, that like you just said, they really don't want it handed to them. They want to earn it, like what you're saying. Do you agree with it? They really truly
exactly.
want to come in.
Which we want to allow them to do.
Right. And they get a certain percent, you know, they get an income. It may not be the greatest, but it's a learning, it's a rebuilding process, right?
It is.
I'm letting them to know that, hey, look, I am human. I am here. And good Lordy, look out, because I am on the road to recovery. And that's about what you're doing, isn't it?
Well, it's not even necessarily a recovery. We're just bringing them back into a very comfortable community, surrounding them by their fellow peers, the same as anyone else wants to be surrounded by people they're comfortable with.
Yeah.
We all have a certain amount of comfort zone, and we're just redeveloping that.
And do you think it's the structure? I mean, I know a lot of veterans that have come back. I mean, my family's chock full of them. I have a bunch of friends, young friends now. And
folks, doesn't she look awesome with that talk? Doesn't she look awesome when out there today?
I'm going to have to give Norm this shirt. He's just
yes,
talked about
I love
it.
Yeah, but okay. Back to where you were.
No, but what I found is that the people that I know, they missed the structure. They got back here and there was nothing.
Exactly. That's definitely one of the parts of it. So it will be structured. It will be regimented. But, I mean, at the same time, you don't miss a lot of that structure. I mean, a lot of veterans, when they were in the military, almost felt like they were being babysat, like being treated like children.
Right, and you don't want that.
So we're not going to do that. But still, I mean, it's going to be a company. It's a privatized company that just employs veterans. And any structure that we do necessarily have, I think those veterans will be able to come in and, let's say, donate themselves. They'll provide that structure and that regimented schedule throughout the day, that we give them a task and we're not going to micromanage them, but go pick this up here, go pick this up here, and do this, and they're going to be able to easily become successful in those roles, because that's exactly what they were allowed to do in the military.
Now, will there be a time limit on that? Like, if they come and they join your group and they join your job service or whatever, and will they be able to be trained to go out on their own, or will there be a time limit that they have to work at in the training, in your process of the training?
So it's within our clauses that have already been established that we want to train them and license them first and foremost. So if they do want to stay with us as a company, we want to be able to provide them that opportunity for a job. But if they just want the training to be able to develop themselves and then move to another company, then we can absolutely do that, because their GI Bill, which they've already earned through active military service, will pay for that schooling.
This is exciting. I remember when you would always had something in mind. Ever since I've known you, I've always wanted to do something.
Well,
you know.
It was really cool to, I mean, like, spend your time in the military and then go to Norwich and study pre-law. But then I've always worked outside, and all three of those worlds are completely separate. They have nothing in common between the military, the legal aspect, and then working outdoors. There, you can find three jobs or right. three activities that are more disassociated.
And you were a landscapist when I first met you.
Oh, yeah. I enjoyed mowing lawns. It's therapeutic for me. You just sit on a mower, it's mindless, and you get to see the fruits of your labor at the end.
Yeah. Right.
So that's a nice part about working outside, but at the same time, I enjoyed separate parts of each of those disciplines. So with this, it kind of dawned on me 18 months ago that we should absolutely, or I should absolutely try and find a way to combine all three of those. And then just in the industry, looking around, trying to develop something, I found that there was so much byproduct that was just given away by these large excavation companies and outdoors companies just for free. So I thought, why not create something that helps all the people I want to help while also providing the industry with the write-off that they're not receiving? Because as a 501c3, all that byproduct that they're just dumping, giving away right now, which is a lot, we're able to provide a taxable write-off for them. So we're going to save that
money.
So
that helps companies too. So more companies should get on board with you.
Absolutely.
I love it. Now, do you go run, to veterans groups and talk about this? I mean, how are you getting the word out?
We're still in the forming stages right now, and we're trying to do just general organic growth. So right now, we are raising funds in order to buy the equipment. So once we do go to those prospective corporate partnerships, we're able to the next day come and pick up whatever they would like to us. So we won't hit the ground running. Rather than go there and trying to develop the partnership without the equipment, we want to be able to have the assets at hand, ready to go, which we should be able to easily within a month.
Excellent.
Let me tell you what I'm looking at with it. As you know, your company, I wouldn't call it a company, your company is going to be so tremendously. It may start off slow, but your company
which is fine. Which is fine, yeah.
But then, you know, you get impatient. You want it to grow quickly, you know. But you're learning how to be patient.
I just came from splitting wood right now. I came right from the wood yard right here. That's why I'm dressed in a hoodie and these
pants. I don't like people coming in all dressed up and they're not really there. I wanted to come. How many people do we have that just come in? You know, this is like a setting in a living room.
I wear jeans every week.
Yeah.
How many? This is what I look like every day doing this job.
Oh, you slob.
I know. But how many? What gave you this motivation to create this project? This is a good word, right?
Yeah.
It started as we saw companies, landscape companies that at the time I was working for Outdoor Pride out of Manchester. It's like a large commercial outdoors company that does like Fidelities, BAEs, all of their maintenance for snow and everything just in that nature. So I was working for them and I asked my friend, Stephen LeBrec from Salem, what do these companies do with all this excess material? Because we're just dumping it, we're throwing it away. I wonder, what do we do? And he's like, you don't get it? He's like, they take this, and they make so much money off it. All this money, but I'm like, so why don't more people do it? He's like, because it's completely painstaking. It takes a lot of time. It takes heavy equipment. He's like, it's a huge pain in the butt. We don't want to deal with that. We don't want no part of that. But then thinking and developing it, at the time, I lost one of my friends to suicide that I deployed with.
I'm sorry.
So that came about, and I thought, I've always been more towards work for what your passion is over profit, because if you're working for your passion, you're going to wake up excited to go to work every single day.
Absolutely.
It's never going to be work. And I can't work at a job for money if I hate the job. I'm going to be horrible at it.
Yeah.
I was never the best student because I never saw any practical application for what I was doing that day. I couldn't see the fruits of my labor. Yes, there was long-term goals, but I couldn't see the outcome every single day. So, I mean, it was a merger of all the ideas at once, the outdoors, the legal, the wanting to help veterans, my buddy. And I was sitting at dinner with my father, and I had an epiphany. Why not make this a nonprofit? And he thought through it, and he's like, I'm going to call my CPA tomorrow. We're going to go there, get all your stuff ready, and we're going to see if this is viable. Because there's no use trying to develop it if it's not a viable idea. So we went there. I stayed up that night for 6 hours getting all the notes on this and this and this and this and this, so we can do this and everything. And I sat down with him, Jules Brayman out of Nashua, New Hampshire, and he had the same kind of moment. He was like, this is an amazing idea. He's like, I'm going to connect you with all these people out of Manchester so it's more local for you and fill me in on where this goes and how it's working and how it's working out for you, because most kids come here from their father's referrals without any preparation. They want to come here and start a company, but they don't even bring a notepad and a pen. And, you know, it's whatever. He still deals with it. But yeah. I came completely prepared, and that one door opened and then the next door opened. And just throughout the entire time, I was receiving the help I needed when I needed it and then working myself. So I was still working 50 hours a week, but every night I try and stay up and do like 6 hours of legal prep, because the document itself for the IRS 501c3 submission, it's 114 pages of legal dissertation. I'm not a lawyer, but I didn't have the $10,000 to pay for a lawyer. So I had to do it on my own.
But no, at least you had some exposure. Like, you know, Norm was trying to establish his nonprofit. Yeah. It's overwhelming for someone who has no legal exposure.
It is, yeah. So Norwich University definitely helped me with that. It's a military school as well, so there's not so much time for...
Would you recommend Norwich University to anybody?
Absolutely. Well, if they're a motivated individual,
right,
they're not going to fix all your problems. But if you go there with just a little bit of want, a little bit of desire as a young man or woman, they're going to make you great. You know, it's in the middle of nowhere, Vermont, but it really isolates.
Well, they don't even have electric lights there yet, do they?
Electric lights?
Electric lights and all that.
No, they have electric lights now.
Yeah, they got them last year.
Now. Yeah,
it was a big party.
Yeah, they installed them recently.
No, actually, it's a very good campus.
It is nice. They have good food, too.
Yeah. I was there for 30 days. Yeah.
Seriously, you're in the middle of nowhere. It's nice.
I was there for 30 days, and that was enough for me. I couldn't handle it anymore. I didn't like, and it's a very structured environment.
And you're isolated. That's it. You're there. It's very isolated.
Yeah. And, well, I'm talking way back. Well, I'm only 34 now.
Right. You know, we all got that. You know,
and way back like 50 years ago, it was really and I was here more to see if I want. And I felt I wasn't military material, so to speak. But I worked on a military base.
It's Snapchat.
There you go.
I'm Snapchatting my friends and I'm here.
Oh, nice. Hey, there you go. Very nice. One of the things I'm looking, I know that you've always had this need to help others. When I met you quite a few years ago, you always had the need to help others. You would always try to be something that you really weren't, like the big boast of it. But yet in heart, you saw the come out and said, you know what, I gotta help others. Because this is who you really... Do we all want to make money? Yeah. I count my money this way, and I cry this way, you know?
Don't let him lie to you people. He bought me a cookie today. And a coffee.
I cried after.
You're right. I don't love you. I love Scott. Sorry.
Yeah, there you go. See? But I love it when I see people... that I'm getting together, younger people, if you don't mind, how old are you?
26.
26. See, folks, all the young people are not all bad people. They're not all drug addicts. They're not all people that go out and want to kill somebody or want to do this or that. Here's a young man at 26 with friends, and they're all around your age, I gather. I try to do something for this. I can't say the word.
Yeah.
Fudgy country. There you say that. For this country. And he was in the military and he did this and that. You know what? And it's my pleasure and honor. And I want to thank you for serving our country, sir. Absolutely. And your friends and everybody that you work with. It is a pleasure to have you here.
And that, as Norm can tell you, I'm a big supporter of veterans and veteran owned companies.
In fact, on May 20th, when day in May? Have you decided yet we're doing the American Legion thing?
The 20th. VFW. But
the VFW? Okay.
Same thing.
Lori and I are going to be doing an event at the VFW for the homeless vets, right?
Well, it's for their fund that they focus on vets and their families, but they also help the community.
Yeah, right. Okay. And it's a pleasure to do. So we got to get back to the community. Do you agree with that? No matter what we get, like with you and like me having this TV show, and I'm excited about it for my 17th year in 2 months. Of course, there again, I was 22 when I started, you know. Nobody ever believes me, though. when a 45-year-old son.
Well, 34 minus 17 doesn't come out to 22, so
well, I can... Well, that one made me 39.
He was an overachiever.
Yeah,
you know. Yeah, there you go.
Well, sorry, I just say he is that good that, you know, he's 34 and his son is 42. He's that good.
44,
he, obviously, he went to Norwich to check
taught
it out.
Taught me a lesson,
in utero, because he wasn't born yet.
But the one thing, I like you being relaxed. I think you're not nervous, right?
Okay.
I love it when
really
all these people go come on our show. And it's warm.
It is warm in
my
here today.
My makeup's running off. Look at that.
I know your mascara.
Oh God! Running. You know. I love it because we'll have a lot of. We have a lot of people that come on. Oh, what am I going to wear? What am I going to do? What am I going to say? And the best thing we tell people—that's
right.
it.
That's it.
Just
be
yourself.
That's it.
I've actually had two people that actually came on, maybe three, that actually out-taught me.
Just two.
Literally out-taught me.
Made him look mute. I mean. In 2 hours, I think he spoke maybe 5 minutes.
You get some chatterboxes on here.
Oh, yeah. And it's great funny. Because it saves me, you know.
But know him. He likes stuff.
Now, these people that come to you for help and stuff, and do they have to be referred to you by another organization, or how does that work?
So it hasn't even actually reached that point yet. Our IRS license was only granted 4 months ago.
Oh.
So we're still working internally to be able to build that foundation
to
help others, because we need revenue before we can do anything. It's the same as the philosophy of a poor man can only help so many, but how many people can a rich man help?
Right.
Like, we need the availability for funds that we are completely willing to generate and give back.
Now, if people want to donate, how do they do that?
Contact us through social media, and once we develop the sites through Greater Manchester, our goal is to develop at least two or three sites within 10 miles each way of Manchester within 2 years, organic materials donation centers. So once they do have those materials from their yard, like dirt, grass clippings, wood chips, once again, they'll be able to contact us or go to one of the sites and just drop it off free of charge. And if it's enough, we can even give them a write-off for their donation. Yeah. Like $5 for a bunch of wood chips, why not?
Why not?
Yeah.
If they can, even now, can they send donations to you now if they want to? Do you have a website?
Like if they wanted
to
send cash donations to...
Yes, no, they absolutely could.
Do you want to tell the people how to do that? Look into the camera and tell them.
Oh, the camera? Oh, I'm on TV?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought the camera was just on you guys. Oh.
Wave to everybody.
Wait, this
way? Yeah.
They have to see who we're talking to. They
so they can send the donations to 7 Wilton Road, Mount Vernon, New Hampshire, 03057. And we will send back a thank you card and the donation receipt, so it's tax write-offable.
Sweet.
Hey, that's a good word. I gotta remember that word. He just used a new word for me. I gotta remember.
Yeah, you'll have to use that when you get your thing up and running. You know.
I just see if you agree with me. I just see such a, it's going to be a slow start because you don't want everything to be rushing.
Well, you want to get through the learning curve.
You
want to get it up and running before you go gangbusters. Yes,
right.
I agree with
and
you.
I actually see you're going to be not only you're in Manchester, that way your main office is going to be, that you're going to be expanding to like Nashville.
Whatever works.
You're going to be all over. You're going to be all over the New England area.
I see this being a huge success. I really do.
I'm not going to tell you. You're going to be bigger than...
I got chills. Thank you.
You're going to be bigger than Goodwill.
If it works and it's beneficial...
We're not going to say works. We're going to say it is going to work.
Repeat
after the "it is going to work."
I absolutely do believe it is going to work.
Thank
but I don't
you.
Want to jinx myself.
What do I say when people say hope?
Yeah, he gets upset when people say
really
hope.
Do you want to know the background story of why I don't want to jinx myself?
Sure.
Sure.
So in high school, I played for Sauhegan Ice Hockey out of Amherst, New Hampshire, and we took states 3 years in a row. And my sophomore year on that team, I was on the varsity team, and I somehow made it to the first or second line, which is one of the two main playing lines in ice hockey. And the coach walks in the room right before the grades came out for the trimester, semester, whatever it was in high school. And jokingly, he looks at all of us and he's like, "Is anyone going to fail all their classes? Is anyone going to fail?" And I knew I had A's and B's. I was fine. I just turned in a major paper that was in three classes. And it was good. I had faith in it. So we're going to be fine. The next day, I get news from my teachers that they thought that I plagiarized the entire paper. and I failed it, and it dragged down my grades, so I could only play half the season with that team. But I was jinxed because I looked at him and I was like, nope, coach, I'm going to fail all my classes. And then I failed all my classes.
Well, see, because you spoke it, though. See, and that's why if you only speak that you're going to be a winner, you'll always be a winner. And people think it's too simple, but it really does work. So don't ever say you're going to fail. Just always say, I'm a winner.
Actually, there's no such thing. There you go.
I do believe that.
There's no such thing as a fail.
Unless you quit.
Unless you walk away and say, I give up. No. Everything in life, you may hit rock bottom on the project, because that means you're going to have to change something.
Just find another avenue.
Find another avenue. Because
that's why I said remain flexible.
Yeah. Right.
You know, if I thought that I was a failure, I wouldn't be where I am today. Believe me, I've hit rock bottom many times. Especially a lot of relationships, you know, and all that, you know.
But not now. But not now. You've been I've been with Scott for 20 years now,
and I love who I am. And I mean, I am the most gorgeous person in the world. You ask me, I'm going to tell you. You know? And this is what I want people to believe. I want people to say, I don't care if you weigh 400 pounds. I don't care if you weigh 10 pounds or 20 or whatever.
That would be a little weird, but yeah, okay. But,
you know, it could be a young child, maybe a baby or something. Okay, but, gotcha. You know, if you might have maybe not the best looking facial problems in the world or whatever. But you know what? You're beautiful. I don't care. You are beautiful. Do you agree with that? That I don't care. You might have had an accident. You might be born with a cut of a leg.
It's you. It's your energy. It's not your physical.
I truly believe in life, no matter if it's someone just passing on the street or the most successful person you know. Everyone you meet in life has something to teach you. They know something that you don't. And if you can find that and have faith that they know that one thing, maybe they'll teach you something great. But at the same time, you have something to teach them.
Yeah.
And you don't have to be overbearing in that nature by any means, but just show them kindness. Yeah. Show them gratitude.
I love to go to Market Basket. I really do. That's Market one of my favorite. Oh, I love it.
Are they sponsoring the show?
No. Oh, yeah.
He holds up a Market Basket.
There you go.
Well, hey.
And
ham is
get a gift card from there because I have a friend that's working.
Right, but that's different.
But I like walking up to you. Hi, how are you? Or how are you? No, I do it on the streets all the time.
Oh, he does. He scares some people. But,
I'm sorry you're having a bad day or whatever. If you send out that positive energy, if you send out that positive light, you know, from that person that might have been down, you might have learned something. Why are you down? That you can learn. Oh, wow.
They could be having a horrible day. You just give them the smallest amount of positivity.
It helps.
Like what you're doing when you're, this is all going to flow into what you're doing, by the way. I may get off the wall. I'm always off the wall. We know
you?
That, right? Yeah.
Wow, what you talking about?
But if you listen to, if you just send that one little hope, or one little, hi, how are you, or maybe a quarter, or maybe a dollar, or whatever. Don't make a habit, folks. I don't make a habit of giving money. I'm too, I'm too Irish. So.
Hey, wait. I'm Irish. What are you saying?
Well,
my name is Shea Sullivan Burke.
Yeah.
Where's the beer?
Yeah, there you go.
Who brought the six pack?
We'll talk about that after the show.
No, but if I shake a hand. Maybe some guy can be home, can be dirty or whatever, but you know what?
It's okay.
Soap and water washes off.
Well, it all comes back to what you said about helping people.
Yeah.
You know, even if that one person on the side of the street, the homeless person, do you have any change in your pocket?
Yeah.
You know, do you? Just give them 50 cents. What's 50 cents to you?
Yeah.
But at the same time, I do also believe in helping people that have earned that help.
Right.
Which to me is the veterans community.
Yeah.
So tying that into everything else, yes, like everyone needs some sort of help, some people more than others, but I want to concentrate and focus on the group that has already given so much. Yeah. And maybe that so much that they gave has altered their lives permanently in a negative manner, which it might have to this point now, homeless veterans alone. Maybe that experience that they had has helped them, but still they're reeling from it. They're hurting and they want that community. We want to be able to, through that community, help in whichever specific way that we have to on a personal level, because money doesn't solve all the problems.
Another question I have is, will it be just for the homeless veteran, or will it be for people who are still trying to get ahead in their life once you get the place established?
So our main focus, our number one cause, is veterans employment.
Okay.
So training the veterans and then bring them into our community. So trucking, material processing, and so forth, everything through that nature. So it's going to take a while to build that base, but once we do, I think it's going to be perpetually growing. Right. Then our other causes include things like creating a veterans activity center. So we want to create a veterans-only activity center with ATVs and quads where they can just go be with other veterans. So for free, they can go ride a dirt bike or a quad or a snowmobile
nice.
A little track for free. Everything costs so much nowadays. If they just want to go hang out, they can call ahead of time, reserve it, and then they might be able to go just mess around for 1 or 2 hours with their buddies who are also veteran. Because every veteran who's home right now knows someone who's in the service with them.
Right.
There's always that one or two or three guys that they call like once or twice a week or see every day, you know. So we want to be able to provide that avenue for them.
Nice.
Folks, if you have any questions you would like to ask him, don't be afraid to give us a call. I don't know the number.
Our new number is probably on your screen, but it's 603-640-3091. And, yeah, please call in and ask Shea some questions, ask Norm and I some questions.
Yeah, you know, we'll do a reading. You know, we do readings a lot, too, on the air as well, okay? But we also, if you don't mind, we got an event coming up here. What is it?
April 8th.
Yeah, that's right, April 8th at the Unitarian Universalist Church.
Hey, you got it right.
Hey, I did, didn't I?
You didn't even have to think about it. It just came right out.
Wow,
thank you.
Yay.
Sorry, it's a big deal.
And here we go.
But, you know, you see he gives me the list.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this time we have greatly expanded the event. And
we went from 12 to 35 to 40.
So
even
though we've greatly expanded the event, we've cut down on the number of readers so that there's more diversity, less duplication of the types of readings.
Mm-hmm.
So for the readers, Norm and I, of course, will be there. And almost everybody on this list, I think everybody on this list has been on the show. So it's somebody you can go back and watch us on YouTube or IPM Nation and see. You know, see what you think of them. So Colleen Costello, Jean Lejeune Gray, Catherine Samuelson, Janice Donnelly, Gail Wall, Laura Joseph, Amy Major, Don Drew, Lisa Moody, Terry Milton, and what's that say?
Dela Bugley? I don't know. Bugley, whatever. Oh, look at Paul. Camera on him. He's taking it off now.
He's taking his clothes off, Pete.
It's awesome.
All right.
Look at his face.
And for vendors, this is just a partial list because we have way more vendors than this. They just haven't confirmed yet. We have Angela Martinez of Bikram Yoga. Now, is she doing a demo this time?
Yeah.
Okay.
She doesn't know it yet, though.
Jen Waltner of Phoenix and Lotus, and she has some amazing card decks and jewelry, all kinds of great things. Elaine Saunders, our favorite matchmaker, she'll be there.
Yeah, we were at Gauchos.
Yeah. Darling Doty will be there with her jewelry. Chris Gately will be there doing chair massage. And while I have yet to have a massage,
really?
I hear that he is like amazingly.
You better get
amazing.
In there early, and you better get
maybe before we open.
Yeah, there you go. This guy does it fantastic, and I don't like people touching me. But this guy, I don't know, he doesn't.
I don't like people touching
me. I really don't.
He doesn't.
No.
Oh.
And I think kissing is the most disgusting thing in the world, but that's okay.
And that's why he was married four times.
That's why I've been married.
We have Marlene. Marlene.
Yep.
Landau.
Yeah.
Danielle Fryer with Forever Aloe. And I'm telling you, we got the toothpaste from her. That stuff is amazing. Pamela Brodier. And
she
Kimberly
does the singing
Barrett.
Bowls, I believe.
Oh, I have some of those. And like I said, those are just the ones that are already confirmed. But we know that
I got like 10
Bob
more coming
will be there.
Oh, yeah, Bob Olson's going to be there.
We've tons of other people.
And this is all going to the Manchester Animal Shelter.
Yes, this is not for our sake. It is for the Manchester Animal Shelter.
And so if you need to have a charity fund, God, let me know. I'll help you raise the money.
Yeah. Or if you want to get some information out there. We had Adventure Cam, a TV show, come in, and somebody came up to them at their first event with us and said, hey, I'd like to give you guys some money.
Yeah.
So, hey, you
so
never
if
know.
You, and if you want to set up a table to help raise money at your event at our event on April 8th, you're more than welcome to.
Yeah, we'd love to.
Okay.
Well, also, it's just to generate awareness.
Right.
Yeah, just info or whatever, you know, and whatever. Yeah. Because and we also got Kitty Kingdom is going to be setting up a table. the alcohol and drug abuse people that we had on the show.
They're going to come. Yeah.
See, our show, Shay, is not just spiritual readings and spiritual lore. Definitely not political. There are a lot of things that Lori and I would get into a lot of problems with.
We disagree on a lot of things.
Yeah,
too.
We do too. You know, but when there's so many political, so many religious programs on that, we don't want to be that type of show. We want to be a community show. You know,
bring people together.
And
not
their them. Show.
Why would you polarize your company?
Exactly. Yeah, we want to bring people together.
Yeah. We're only the tools, and it's a community show. Right. Like anytime, you know, like inviting you to come on and talk about what you have. Anytime you feel you need to, you're more than welcome to.
Yeah.
Because it is. It is. We're only the vessels. Right. Boy, have I been told that more than once. I've had my ego knocked down so many effing times.
He has an ego. Hard to believe. Oh. Can you imagine?
You know.
This room's almost not big enough.
Really? You know?
He does know you.
We've known each other a long time. But I actually, one time when I first started out, I think we were on Commercial Street, I believe it was called, you know, when the first, you know, whatever out of the show. And let me tell you, I thought I was I still think I am, but not quite as bad. But I thought because all these people were coming on my show, I would not associate with the other readers at the events. I really wouldn't. I'd have to have a room by myself. And I had it. And I had the people coming in.
All of a
sudden. I'm sorry?
Prima donna?
Yeah, I really was. You know, I think I had a tiara, too, on my show one day. The Miss Queen on there. You know, you wouldn't be amazed at what I've had on my show. But I was looking in the mirror, in the bathroom, the mirror says to, and I said, who the hell do you think you are? I go, I'm the great, who said so? I went, well, me, you know, and really, I'm going to tell you, it really brought me down on my knees.
Humbling experience.
Oh, let me tell you. And here I am washing my hands. All of a sudden, that waterfall, and I kid you not, went all on. I was wiping myself off from the water and all that. I said, okay, what do you want me to do? You are going to go in there, and you're going to apologize to your guest, and you're going to apologize to the people that are out there watching you.
I am?
No, mirror told
No, no, sorry.
I'm like, what I do?
Yeah, you know, no. So I had to walk out there, and I said, and I'm wiping like, and they're all like, what happened to you? You know, I said, you don't want to know. And I said, folks, all of a sudden one person said, here we go again. You know, they thought it was going to be a little sarcastic moves, you know. I said, I owe each and every one of you and the people out here an apology. And one of the friends, I think her name was Melissa Beard, and she said, this is the first, folks, you all heard it. And when she typed it, not on the internet, you know, she's really getting going. I go, and I looked at Matt, because he came by, I said, I owe you an apology, and you know the people who are wrong. And I said, I really literally started crying, because I, you know, I really said, and I said, my God, what have I done? I'm not that John Edwards. I'm not Sylvia Brown. I'm not. I am Norman Moody from a wonderful city of Manchester, and I am very humble and still learning to be the spiritual leader that I am today. And you know, that's when I started feeling a lot of the negative energy released. We had the event at the Manchester TV station back then. It was successful. And when I started throwing away all my, and it was rough, don't get me wrong. It was rough when I started throwing away all my ego, because, you know, I would never have a big ego, you know. No. And then one of the biggest things that came to me, Shay, is when I put her and Norm Lori and friends. It used to be just Norm and friends, right? And then I texted you and I said, can I put you as Norm Lori and friends? That's when I knew that I had lost a lot of my ego. I still have it. We got to have ego.
But as a tool.
It's a balance like everything else. It almost sounds like you had a moment of self-awareness.
Yeah.
You're able to look at yourself from an external, like a third-party perspective.
Yeah. Have you ever heard about out-of-body experiences, right? You probably have done them, you know. And I was actually looking down on my, have you ever done out-of-body? So you know what I'm talking about, right? And a lot of times.
God, I need to lose some pounds. Looking at
you. Oh, yeah, I tell you, it really makes you look at yourself very differently.
It does, on a deeper level. I'd agree.
How's your mother doing?
She's good.
She's on vacation right now, right? school vacation?
She just got back from Florida visiting her parents, my grandparents. Oh. So, I mean, she's putting a new bathroom in her house. She's still working. Mainly, she's in support of dirt veterans right now, though. Actually, I moved home temporarily until we find where we're purchasing or leasing the property for dirt veterans, because I want to be able to make myself fully available to this cause. So rather than spend that extra 20 minutes a day commuting back and forth each way, I'd much rather prefer to be 5 minutes away. So I'm right there.
Mother loved having you home. You know that.
Yeah, well, I'm sure balance once again.
Let's be honest.
There's that. And it's nice also, too, because all I do is really just go home and sleep, and then I'm up in the morning going back to do
What did you get the name Dirt Veterans?
I'm a big believer in just simplicity in names. If I owned a storage company, it would be Storage Co. If I owned a refrigerator company, it would be Refrigerator Co. So this idea is essentially materials or dirt for veterans. Well, please give us your materials, and then
so you're more into organic type things, though.
Yep. So it's all going to be in an eco-friendly manner. So essentially, it's eco-friendly outdoors recycling, if you will, wood recycling, composting. So it's actually very easy for us to complete that successfully as well, because all of our machines, rather than use hydraulic oil, we can use like special components to replace it with like peanut butter oil. Peanut oil. Butter. Excuse me. Yeah. Yeah, peanut butter in the machine.
Yeah,
all right, folks, you heard that. That's really a prayer.
Yeah. Yeah, a slip. No, but we're able to take what is otherwise discarded and process it into things that people need and use every day.
Okay, supposing I own a farm, okay? Now, and I needed some of that compost. Do you deliver it? We'll say stuff because it's organic, right? So if I wanted to start a garden, and that's what you people would be doing, coming and delivering the compost and putting it into the garden and that one.
Ooh. So we would sell, we're trying to focus just exactly on the basics. So we would sell, let's say, the bark mulch to either the homeowner, residential or commercial, or the landscaper. So whoever needs it. So we wouldn't be the ones necessarily to come and spread it, but you would know that it was Dirt Veterans materials.
And the thing I like about it is organic.
Right, right.
Hey, they can come down and take all your stuff, because you're pretty much organic, right?
Yes, we are completely organic in our yard. But now I'm just thinking in my head, I'm wondering, I know the guys who own Abel Ebenezer Brewery who are veterans. It's a veteran-owned company. And they used to make hot dog rolls out of the waste from their beer, but I don't know what they're doing with it now. So that would be
hot dog rolls.
Yeah, they were really good. Yeah,
even restaurant waste.
Yeah.
Take that, compost it, and rather than have the small turn machine in your yard, we're gonna have large loaders, front loaders, the big ones that you see pushing the snow.
You might want to go and check out that they'll be one of your sponsors.
We'd more than happily. Yeah.
Okay, what's it called?
Abel Ebenezer.
Yeah,
Abel Ebenezer.
I love those guys.
And he was on our show.
Can't say enough about them. They are wonderful.
Where are they out of?
Merrimack.
Merrimack.
Yeah, you're familiar with Merrimack.
Very veteran supportive.
Well, because they're veterans.
Yeah, they're very veteran. You know, they support the veterans very much.
Good. Yeah.
You know, and so I think that would be cool. But the one problem. Don't be at all surprised if you get anti veterans protesting, and I'm dead serious when I say that, because the sad part is there are a lot of them out there that don't know what the hell they're protesting, but they do it anyways.
And that's their right to. They can. It doesn't faze me whatsoever.
No, but see, that's the thing. That's what you guys went to war or went in the military. But you give us the right to do what we're doing today. You're helping us to defend our. Would you do it again?
The way I see it is we're protecting a way of life.
Yeah.
So not necessarily, when people say we're protecting that freedom, it kind of misconstrues it, because we aren't necessarily protecting their right to object upon what we're doing, but we're protecting and preserving the small piece of happiness that we have been able to create here. So all this criticism of society doing this, and it used to be better, and there were so many better things in the past. Maybe so, but personally, I don't agree with that, because I've been to Afghanistan and the Middle East and seen how horrible their lives are and how miserable the people are and how they all want to come here. Even if they despise America, a lot of them look at America as the pinnacle of success. If they're able to come here, then they've done something and they can succeed on their own right, because in their own countries, they've
had balls.
built up around them.
We were talking about how, you know, people don't understand how hard it is in these countries just to live. Now, obviously, I've only been to Turkey, but I've never been in the military, but all my family has been.
It really makes you appreciate how good we have it here.
Right. We are very blessed in this country. And, you know, most of them don't hate America, despite what we're told.
No, it's like 10%.
Even if they do, it's just it's generated off of perspective. Their friends heard it, so their friends heard it, their family heard it, they told them. It's never their experience with
right.
us. And when we were there, it was nice because we were able to talk to the Afghans and kind of clear the air with that. Oh, do you guys do this? No, we don't do that.
Well, it's the same when we went into Vietnam or when we went into Korea. You know, they all had those same misconceptions too. It's just about everybody learning that we're all human and we all want the same things, to be happy and to be loved.
Yeah.
I actually, even though I was never in the military, my two brothers were, because I had one eye that caked me out, but I did work at a military base. And I would get so angry at these people that were wearing the American flag on their butts back in the 60s or really doing that. And then my brother says, that's what they went to the military for, so that we could have, so that people could come and be expressive or that, you know. Would you do it again? Would you go back in and do it all over again?
Yeah, I would.
That's what I've heard about most people say. Then, you know, and folks, if you are sadly, and there shouldn't be homeless vets. They should not be.
Well,
and
there shouldn't be anybody homeless.
Anybody should not be homeless.
No,
but our vets deserve more.
I was talking to Glenn. And, you know, I don't think he's still there or not. Maybe come in and give a comment about this. Manchester politicians want to hide the fact that we have homeless people. Vets or homeless people. They had literally taken the park benches out of the parks.
Yeah.
And whatever, because homeless is everywhere. And in this country, there are places to go to get food, to eat and stuff, but there's a lot of them that won't go because of the rules and regulations. And what you're doing is you're not, you're giving them a chance, if I am correct. And boy, I feel intelligent today.
All you can provide is an opportunity.
Yeah, that's right. What I'm saying. You're offering them a chance. You're going to have some that are not going to stay in, so I'm going to leave the program.
That's fine, because we provided that opportunity.
Right.
Them. It's
and,
all for them.
Yeah, and it's all up to them. It's up to them if they want to make it or not. And one of the things I do see is that the people that are help training your staff, that are help training the people to get better lives and stuff, that you're going to be a no-nonsense. But you're going to do it with compassion. You don't see what I mean? In other words, your volunteers are going to want to do it or don't be there. Don't waste your time.
It's not going to be absurdly hard or rigorous like the military.
It's
going to be a job. We provide you with the training, the support you need, but at the same time, you need to show up on time, and there's a job you have to do. And they'll be provided with ownership over their equipment that they utilize and have every day. And their role that they're playing within the company, they're not going to be micromanaged, but at the same time, there's going to be a support system that we help them. But you can only help someone so much. What's the analogy? You can bring a horse to water, but you can't make it drink.
Right.
So we just want to provide that opportunity to them.
My major goal, if I ever won a lot of money, would be I would like to start a lodge with what you're offering, but I would also like to have it. They have to be a married couple. Or a couple that live together. Unfortunately, there's so many people out there that are married, but they can't live together in a shelter. I believe they have to live in different shelters or what they can't be.
Oh, the homeless persons.
The homeless people, whether veterans or non-veterans or whatever. And my goal is to have them come in and each one of them work at a different job. And like you say, training in a hotel management, maybe being a cleaner lady. Okay, thank you,
Anne. Sure.
Or someone learned how to do like you said, maybe you could have your company come in and teach them how to composting or whatever. My goal is to help everybody. I've been there, I know what it's like, and the help that I got from, not everybody, but my goal is, like yours, is to help the people to help better themselves.
Give them tools. Give them opportunities.
Right. But I'm not going to hold it. I don't picture you holding their hands.
That's just it. It's all situational, case by case.
Right.
If there was a carpet blanket solution to this, it would already be solved.
Right.
But there isn't.
You know. And I will tell you, you're not that far from being up and running.
No, we've done the groundwork. We have a great team, and everyone on board is selfless. There's no greed. They all just want to help.
And that's not an I group either, or maybe.
No. If anything, like my friend Steve, he said he wanted to go split wood today. I wasn't necessarily planning on splitting wood, but I made time, rearranged, and I got there to help him because it stinks splitting wood alone. It's way easier with two people, so you help each other out. And things are so much easier as a team because with the ego, like you touched on, but at the same time, the compassion, helping people. In the military, they teach a team effort. Like, realize that you aren't the best at everything. You don't know everything. Yet, even the generals don't know anything. The generals are put in teams to brainstorm because everyone is good at one specific thing. And if you find out what that is within your team, you develop a role, and everyone knows that you're the go-to guy for that role. And developing that thought process together is the teamwork.
Right, and that's what I love about what you're doing is you have a team, and you want to build a team. You don't want to build minions. You want a team.
No, everyone's going to be a team.
And I love that. I love that. And so tell people again the name of your company. Give them all your social media sites and stuff like that.
It's Dirt for Veterans Incorporated. We have a website up, dirtveterans.com. And on social media, it is at Dirt Veterans.
So we're on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter.
All of that.
Imagine what you can do with a computer
today. That was the very first thing I reserved when I came up with this idea. I logged in all social media and reserved the name. I'm like, I don't want anyone taking it.
I don't blame it. Imagine what you can do with a computer today. You know, I'm changing my author's name from Norm Second World to Spiritual Readings by Norm. I like that better. What do you think?
I think that fits better.
You know how I don't like the word.
Yeah.
You know, psychic. I really don't. But I use it because it makes money. I mean, I'm not stupid either. Well, I'm a little stupid, but not all the way yet. You know, because I got told I was very flamboyant on TV. I would never know why they would get that idea.
You flamboyant? Yeah. You are so subtle.
I know. I sit there like this. I want to also encourage you to have your own TV show. I'm dead serious. To tell about what you're doing, to even a half-hour show. Hey,
if anything, it would be like a podcast, an update, I think.
Yeah.
Because once again, touching on our focus, that would take away from our focus of being in the field and operating.
How about anytime you want to come on, you're welcome to come on and show, tell us what you're doing. Would that be a cool idea?
Yeah, this is the first time Dirt Veterans has done anything of any sort of media.
And we have a good friend, Mary LeMay, has a show.
Yeah, she does too. She
a half an hour show she would love to have you on.
We're taking all the opportunities.
We'll get you the exposure.
Yeah, please do.
Okay.
Yeah, just to get us out there. That's what we need. We need people to know about us.
And bring in your table and all that, at the event we got coming up.
Of course.
We give you everybody a chance. There's a young girl. I'm going to tell you, what was her name? Heidi?
Which young girl are you talking about?
The one from
Hannah?
Hannah, yeah. Well, I was almost right. Almost, But she started, her and her family were down and out. They had absolutely nothing. And we liked telling the story because here's a young girl that was, 12?
She was, 13? She was young at the time, yeah.
And she started this fund. Okay, but Halloween trail, whatever.
A haunted trail on Halloween.
Yeah, and she started this fund, and she's been growing every year with it, and she's growing and growing, and she's helping, not herself. She goes to the Market Basket or Hennepin's and takes the names of the tree off the tree.
Wait, she sets it up in the Market Basket?
No.
The haunted trail?
She sets up a haunted trail at their home in Pelham. They do is they raise all this money, but they take, even though her family was struggling, I mean, they had lost their homes, everything. They take nothing out of this fund. They give it all to other people. So they go and they take the names off the giving trees, library or the banks or whatever. They get different charities contact them, and they donate everything that they raise at this haunted trail for other people.
That's so positive.
Yeah. It's an amazing, this young girl came up with this on her own. Now her whole family's involved. And they, you know, every year it gets better and better.
Well, in October, we'll just let them set up. Yeah, every year we'll just, in October, we'll set up another booth again for them. Just, they were only there for like 2 or 3 hours or 4 hours.
Right, because they were like, so busy.
They made $400.
Yeah.
So this is what, there again, you know, when you hear about, oh, this kid did this, or you hear, you don't hear about the good things that people do like your age, you know what I'm saying? And the, you know,
maybe that's because people like us are busy. And all the nonsense ones are out there spewing it. They're giving us a bad rap.
Yeah, you know, that's a sad
part. We're busy working.
Yeah. And, all they do is smoke dope. Well, nothing wrong with that, but I mean, all they do is, you know, drink, do this, they beat people up, or they go out, they rob, they steal. Folks, here's a kid, 26 years old, right? And here he is, he's doing something positive.
And giving back.
And giving back to the community, giving back to the Uncle Sam, or as they call it, giving that to the community. Can't say enough about it.
Oh,
and you lowlifes who put down these veterans and or put down anybody that is respecting our country and doing what they can, you know what? You're lowlifes as far as I'm concerned. And I have the right to say that because that's the way I feel. If you can't support the armed forces, you may not agree with what they're doing, and I'm sure there are going to be a lot of people that don't agree with what I do, okay? But if you can't be honest, and, you know, at least show them some respect. They went out there so you don't have to respect them, I guess that makes sense. But you know what? They're doing something that you chose to do it, right? I mean, you weren't drafted.
Yeah. We've been a volunteer force since Vietnam.
Yeah, we don't have the draft anymore.
Because, yeah, that's right. Yeah. I went down. I tried. I even almost got arrested for trying to, you know. Oh, no, I never took the test. And all, I have an eye that never grew. And I wanted to go in the military. So I always felt that I was never, and I, to this day, I always feel that I am not complete because I was not able to serve in the military.
Yeah, it's definitely a calling.
Yeah, you know, and because I had this one little eye problem, but that's okay. I look at it today. I did work on it, and now I'm doing a lot to help other people. But I always had that one part because my two brothers, oh, you weren't in the military, blah, 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 you know, they never, and then plus being gay, you can't be in the military back then, whatever, back in the 50s and 60s, you don't tell. And I remember this one kid, he really didn't want to go in the military, so they asked him what his religion was. He said he was Home Baptist, with him, and they looked at this and said, you know what, he said, I'm Home Baptist, so they rejected him. This is way back, and I'm talking way back in the late 50s, early 60s, goes to show you how old I was. You know,
yeah.
But back then the laws were a lot different than they are today. They're more open. I'm telling you, when
you can be openly gay,
theoretically.
Yeah.
Yeah. Theoretically. Yeah.
If I was gay, which I'm not, I definitely wouldn't have told my Marine Infantry Battalion.
No.
No. Way. There's some things you put on paper and that's the way they go, and then there's other things that happen in person. And I mean, I personally wouldn't. It might. Other people might thrive in that environment. Good for them. The personal my preference would be just not to say anything, you know.
Yeah, you don't have to tell.
No, you wouldn't have to. Like, but at the same time, who cares?
Yeah.
Who cares?
You know,
make a big deal of it, but it doesn't really matter. It's not what we're about.
It's okay to be gay. It's okay to be straight. It's okay to be whatever that you want to be.
I am probably, honestly, I am probably the most anti-gay person that you've ever met. First of all, I don't believe in all things gay rights. I don't want any more rights than you have. I don't want any more rights than she has.
No, but gay rights movement is so that you have equal rights. Yeah. That's what it's for, so you have overboard. Equal rights.
As far as I'm concerned, they go overboard. But
you think anybody who stands up for their specific self goes overboard?
I really
overboard.
Do. I think that they go
and
overboard.
And I disagree.
But that's
I think
cool. But that's
you
got
to fight for your right to be.
Yeah, too.
I mean, it personally doesn't affect me, so I can't really... I say I have an opinion on it.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. No, one of my best friends is gay.
You don't have to worry about it.
One of my best friends is gay. I had dinner with him right after his wedding in Manchester, New Hampshire. Like, it doesn't bother me.
Right.
He likes him. But whatever.
It's only
they're both cool guys.
Right?
It's
doesn't matter.
The war, you know. But I love who I am. You know, I live this so-called street. But I love... Actually, I am no sex.
Huh?
I'm not gay, I'm not straight, I'm not anything. I am a spirit that helps other people. And so I don't really, because labels are unimportant.
And that's, that is the truth right there, and everybody should jump on that. Labels are unimportant. When you have to label something, that's a weakness on your part.
Right, and that's why I look at it.
We're all people.
I am who I am, and I'm not, you know. And I've been with a female person for 20 years. Wow, that's a long time. I don't know how he put up with me, but...
Because he's a saint.
Yeah.
I read online something today that, or recently that kind of touches on this, that...
I have no idea what we got on.
We're born into countries, families of certain ethnicity and a certain religion, and we're given all these labels before we're even allowed to think for ourselves.
Right.
And then we isolate ourselves within whatever labels we've been provided and then hate others for it, when on a human level we all pretty much want the same thing.
Exactly.
So yes, is that a great philosophy? It is awesome, but at the same time, realistically, that's how it is. You know,
but we can change that. We can choose to change that by everybody just accepting that they are who they are and being who they are and not the labels that we're given.
You know, the other day I had a diversified day in my office. I had a person from Kenya. I had another lady from Argentina, and another couple from Italy, and then I had another lady from Brazil.
Sounds like a beginning of a joke.
No. I'm just showing you that.
There's a guy from Africa.
No. If you look at them all, I didn't see the color.
Right.
I didn't see the country they were from. Maybe 20 years ago, you just saw people, though. I just saw them all wanted to come get help.
But was it you were one-on-one with them? When you're one-on-one with someone, you're able to talk with them on a personal level.
Yeah.
But when we isolate ourselves in these groups, then everyone hates each other.
There is so much hate. And part of what you're doing, I don't know if you realize it or not, is part of what you're doing with the Dirt for Vets.
Dirt for
Veterans, is you're helping to remove a lot of that hate. Think about it. You're giving these homeless vets an opportunity. You're helping them to get rid of the anger and the hate they may have against us because they are in that situation. But you're really helping them to help themselves. And also, as you're doing that, you're giving them a positive way of looking at life. Hey, that was a great philosophy. Oh, my God.
Yeah, you were on a roll, buddy. Wait till you watch
but
this
does that
replay.
Make sense to you?
It does. We're going to do the most we can with what we have. I'm going to do what I can.
If I can ever do anything.
As long as I can.
Yeah, I think I told you, too, if I can ever be like a spiritual advisor with you and with any of them that want to come and listen, I'll be more than happy to help you. Okay? I'll tell you the bill. I'll send you the ability in a year, like a couple hundred thousand. No, you know.
The invoice.
Here's a check.
Shea just had a heart attack in the office.
Now, catch a check if you can. Well, that's like, I also see, I see this new program they have with people in prison about how they're working with dogs, and it's really working well.
Yeah.
You know. I know the actions, a lot of it, people are very bad, the child molestation, they're killing them. But you know what? No matter how bad a person is, there's always something good in them. Sometimes it takes, we just have to work very hard to get it, And hate is such an easy thing to do.
It's contagious.
It is. And people, the news media and all that, and I am going to blame a lot on the news media.
Go for it.
Because they keep pushing. They want you to hate. They don't want you to help each other. They don't want you to say, how can we do this? Folks, here's a guy that should get a recognition in the union leader, or the useless leader, as I like calling it. I should say that because I get it for free, though. Okay.
Doesn't make it any more useful.
No. Or the Hippo Press, or any Nike National. This is the type of thing that should be put into the news. Do you agree with that?
Oh, I 100% agree that he should be making all kinds of news. People should be aware. I love it. I love your program. I love what you're doing. I love that you're giving back. I just love everything about you in this program, and I think everybody should hear about it.
Thank you. It means a lot, and we are legitimately trying as hard as we can and as best we know how.
And your friends are listening to you?
I believe so, yeah. I told them about it. Maybe they aren't.
Well, actually, you'll be on it. We're on a lot.
Yes.
We were on this morning at 8 o'clock. We're on Fridays at 9, I believe. We're on Tuesdays at 6 in the morning.
Yeah, I know it changed.
And Sunday thing, you can watch it on the channel here on channel 23. You can watch a rerun of you being on there. And you can also download the show from as well. We'll be downloading this, and we'll be putting it on YouTube.
And then it gets put on IPMNation.com.
Yeah, then it gets on
IPMNation. You can get it off his website.
Yeah, that's cool. I can brag about it.
The brag away,
internationally
buddy.
Known.
We are, in fact, internationally known.
Good.
So all around the world, they're hearing your story right now, and hopefully...
Help us.
That's it.
Help us, please. We're trying hard.
Website again?
Dirtveterans.com,
and they want to send a donation?
Which is connected through the website.
Okay.
I mean, so actually right now, staying at home with my mom rather than purchasing a house. I still work full-time. Rather than purchasing a house, I'm taking out a VA small business loan.
I love it.
Just to get the capital that we need.
It's just good business sense.
Just get the capital that we need to get the equipment, get the land, and necessarily just get that going, because we already have donations coming in, but it's the classic scenario of a chicken and the egg. Which one came first? You need one to get the other. So I'm just going to take out that loan, and then we're going to get our equipment, and then we can build upon that.
Now, is there any type of a grant that you can get from the Veterans Association that you wouldn't have to pay back?
I'm sure there are, but we need this now.
Okay.
Grants are difficult. They're hard to write. It takes a long time.
So large nonprofits actually have full-time staff to write grants for them. We'll write grant applications for them.
But there are grant writers out there. So if you're listening and you want to help this great cause, please contact Shea and help them out.
And you're not bashful to take it help, are you? If somebody wants to volunteer
absolutely.
To help you.
Well, it's the same philosophy of teamwork. If you can help us, please contact us.
Yeah.
Any positive help that we can receive is more than appreciated.
Yeah. I love it.
Maybe you can get in and do a pole dance for you.
Oh, Norman, you're obsessed with pole dances.
I am.
Scary.
I am, but I never get lucky out of that.
Hey, you get me that loan, I'll give a pole dance.
Yeah, you
hear
that?
Okay, it's out there now around the world. So.
There you go. Now, look at him blush now.
We're going to do whatever it takes over here, Dirt Veterans.
Hey, folks, here we go. Hey, I'll tell you what, folks, if you want to donate to this, I'll auction them off right now. Can I get a $100 bid? You know, here we go. We'll go $100.
Good thing Paul's not here. He'd be yelling at you.
So we auctioned off our guests for pole dancing. I gave consent.
Yeah, maybe. You know, but we will look forward to actually helping you anyway. Like I said, having an event. You know a lot of psychics, a lot of...
I do.
We could do that. We could maybe go to an American Legion or VFW or something like that.
We might be able to get them to donate the space.
Yeah, well, you know, donate the space to us.
That'll
you know,
be
whatever.
Awesome.
As opposed
and
to
we'll
charging
have it,
you for the
you know,
whole
thing. I mean, we can get, I'm not going to say it'll be a whole lot of money, but maybe a couple of thousand.
Anything else.
Yeah. And we've been pretty successful with our event for the animal shelter.
Yeah. Yes, we have. But we are expanding now to other charities.
Yep. Oh, yeah. I, you know, it's really weird. I think it was either Amy Majors or I don't know, another
one of them, right?
That said, you're going to be doing more events. And I looked at her and I actually looked at her to say, yeah, right, you know. And you know what? I actually am doing more events.
Yeah.
I'm doing one with you and they.
Yes, yes.
And I'm planning a whispered hope or something like that for animals, what else do you call it? Up in Jefferson or whatever the name of it.
There's Jaffrey.
Jaffrey, that's
okay,
the
that's
one.
Okay, that's where my daughter lives, yeah.
Okay, I already got your name down as a reader, so.
Well, thanks for letting me know. Tell me what day it is.
Well, I am already, you know. But it's for the animals again up there.
Yeah.
And I love doing, I don't want to make a whole lot of money. I don't make money off of what I do here at the church. And I can honestly say that without any, what's the word?
Trepidation?
Yeah, anything. Whatever reading that I do, it all stays with the charity that I do.
And
like if I do a charity for you, that would be all the money that I would make would go to you. I wouldn't get a percentage of it. Because I truly believe in you've got to give back. And I would be truly, and if I don't believe in what I'm doing, then I'm not going
to
do it.
But you have to give it to yourself, too. Remember yeah. that lesson. We're working on that.
Oh, yeah. But I do that, too. But I'm happy doing what I do.
Well, and just since we're talking about doing events, this Saturday I will be at the Pepperell VFW doing a charity event out there with your friend Angie and our friend Dr. Kevin. And
he's your friend.
To help Pepperell save their 4th of July celebration.
That's good. Oh, yeah, well, she's coming on in 2 weeks.
Yep.
Okay. And it was really amazing that it's so important. Like for a long time, Angie and I had this wall between because a lot of illy and stupid gossip. And she took it to heart. I took it to heart. And then we met one day, and I'll tell you, it was like old time. We apologized. We had it was like we were just like teenagers, I guess, having old time meetings and stuff. 'Cause she doesn't always like the way I do things, and then when I do crossovers, and I talk to the people who have crossed over, sometimes she thinks it's a little too vulgar. And I call it the way that Spirit tells me.
Yeah, you got to say what Spirit says to
did
you.
Did your grandfather on your mother's side pass away?
No, he's still alive. He's actually helping me, teaching me how to.
Oh, okay. Well, who's the older gentleman? Did your father's father pass?
Father's father, yeah. He was actually one of the founders of the U.S. Navy SEAL program. So okay. He was, that's where the whole Marine.
Okay. I have
if
to
if
give
everyone
you,
doesn't
okay.
know,
I don't know which
Marines
way, but there's
Navy
one there to tell you. I tell you. He's
but
very,
hate each other at the same time.
Right. He's well, very proud of what you're
doing. They'll help each other in a heartbeat, though.
Yeah. He's very proud of what you're doing. And he is also, many tears are being shed because you were Peck's bad boy at one time, but he's very proud of what you're doing, and he wants to help you to let people, and spiritually people say, but they're dead, how can they do that? But they can do it.
Oh,
spirit
absolutely.
Can do whatever they want to do, and he's going to help promote you. He's got you 100% in the work that you're doing. Did you know him?
A little bit.
Yeah. Well, he knows you pretty well.
So he went through a horrible time in World War II. He was one of the first to hit Omaha Beach, Normandy.
Yeah.
He hit the beach 2 hours before the Army, and his SEAL unit, they called them UDTs back then, his UDT unit had a 98% casualty rating. So his job was to clear the paths for the Sherman tanks that were going to float in and then assault the beach. But there was a storm, the Sherman tanks sunk, so the path that they cleared wasn't even useful. So he had to hide on top of one of the pillboxes. So needless to say, he had a horrible time through the entire war. He was shot twice. He had to fight for his life numerous occasions. And when he came home, he wasn't ever the same guy. So he suffered through his entire life. Then when it came time for me to serve, because there was an active war going on in Afghanistan and Iraq, he begged and pleaded with me not to go, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. And he passed. And in that same year, I signed up and joined and was in boot camp. He was definitely a huge influence. But at the same time, I see it as genetically, the driving influences that made him want to become so successful and ambitious in the Navy. I was the same age, and I'm 25% of him. I'm going to be the same sort of drive. So he got like one of the top graduates through the SEAL class when he was in training. I got honor grad at boot camp. I got meritorious mast at the School of Infantry, Camp Lejeune. So we both succeeded, but then at the same time, when we were there and experiencing what they had us doing, it's never exactly what you think it's going to be.
Right.
So you sign up for the story and then it's a little bit different and you come home and you're always going to be altered for it, but then there's still an opportunity to make a change. You don't have to stay that way, which is what I found out.
Which I think, like I said, I have a bunch of veterans in my family, a lot of friends that are veterans. Most of them come to understand that they can make their life whatever it is when they come back. But there are a few that get stuck. I have one young friend that I care a great deal about that just can't get past what he saw when he was over there. A friend of his blew up right in front of him. How do you get over that?
And so, some wounds can't be healed,
right,
unfortunately, but that person still needs support and help. I mean, he might not ever be able to fully heal. But just that support and positivity being brought back into his life. And another thing about dirt veterans is it'll allow them to stay active. So it's not an office environment where you're sitting dormant all day. It's staying active physically. So rather than getting home just drained at the end of the day mentally, you're drained physically, and you want to sleep and you want to rest. The same as in the military, they have you working every single day.
Right, and that I think is one of the things I like about your program is you're getting them active and engaged. Oh, I don't know how to answer the phone. Oh, let's try this. Nope. Oh, swipe. Hi, Al. Are you there?
Sorry, that other number did not work.
It didn't. I'm sorry.
I did not get through.
Huh. That's weird. I'll let them know that it didn't work. So, yeah.
How are you? How's are you today?
We're doing good, Al. How are you?
How's it? A lot of calls?
We haven't had any calls today, oddly, but maybe that's because, as you said, that line didn't work when you tried it. And that's a brand new line.
Yeah,
so.
It didn't work, no.
Well, that's a bummer. Well, for those who don't know, this is our good buddy Al Kaprayan. He's calling in. So what's going on, Al?
What's Norm up to today?
Hi, Al.
He had just stepped away, but he's back.
I had to call your cell phone. The other number did not go through.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that might be why we haven't gotten any calls
today. Yeah, could be, yeah. So what's going on, Al? We have a very interesting gentleman here who is starting a work program for veterans.
Oh, good.
You know. So, hey, what do you think about the Boston Bruins?
They won last. Tomorrow night they're playing New York Rangers. So, you think they're going to win tomorrow night?
I really think so. Are you a Bruins fan?
Okay, you're going to have to hold that call.
Yeah. Okay. Then one of the things that I look at with that, too, is that they had to get rid of Julian.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah, because they're not being held back right now.
Oh, thank you.
You know, they're not being held back right now. Okay? I think it's going to be a tough game, but I think we're going to pull it out. Hopefully, there'll be a lot of fist fights.
Hey.
Oh, yeah.
Don't you agree?
Anyway, Norm,
it's part of hockey. It is.
Well, I'll tell you, what I'm looking at in the middle of March, we're going to have one more big, big storm.
Yeah, I expect a couple.
One or two this month.
And another one, worse than what we had the last storm.
You think it'll be worse?
Yep. Because people are taking it too much for granted, so I'm going to show you who the boss is, so to speak, you know. You know, and like that, you know. So, yeah, it's still going to be good. But we're still going to, you know, no matter what, you still got to love the weather, whether it's bad, good, or indifferent.
Yeah, it's always changing, too. We have record-breaking temperatures last Thursday, Friday, Saturday, which was a tease. But it's going to feel like it's going to be a drastic shock to our bodies come for Saturday morning when we go outside and it's below 20.
Yes.
So I guess I better not wear my dress or skirt. It might be too cold. Yeah. All righty. Give me a call Sunday, all right?
Yep. We'll talk to you Sunday
night. All righty.
Bye, Al.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I wonder if somehow his number got blocked by the station.
I wonder why would that be, though?
Well, I think it just accidentally, you know, because, like, they had to block the lady that called harassing him all the time. I wonder if somehow.
Maybe.
That's why he
can't.
Yeah,
that it could be misdialing.
Yeah, the old number and the new number?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I have to check. Al's a great guy.
Yeah.
If you've never met him,
you know Al Kaprayan, right? The weather guy? He used to be a WBIN.
He's young. He may not remember.
Well, he used to go to the schools. Yeah, he's actually a very good friend of mine. He's been, you know, a meteorologist for many years. He was a, he was actually one of the co-hosts for my show for about a year and a half to 2 years with Matt and I, you know. And I've gone through a lot of co-hosts, but this is the one I'm not going to get rid of. If I had to tie her to the chair and make her stay.
Getting into something new, are you?
Yeah. Well,
how long have you guys been on the show together?
Almost 3 years.
Yeah, 3 years in July, right?
Yep, three years in July.
Yeah. It's quite the commitment.
Yeah, it is. I believe it.
You have no idea.
The biggest commitment.
And I'm not easy, you know. But Matt and I were on for 7 years. And then I got to the point where I made I'm going to let him hang himself. Because when I got to the point where I almost didn't want to go on the air anymore. That's how bad it was getting. And all of a sudden he told me he couldn't make it one day. And I go, ha, 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 he's in my chair. And I called her on the phone, right?
Either that or you messaged
yeah,
me.
What
or
a
the
message,
other.
Yeah,
what message. I said, I'll try it for a week or two, see. But I made no commitments, and I still haven't left yet. So.
Yeah. I've gone through a lot of co-hosts, you know, and the one thing that we share a lot spiritually, but politically we do not, you know, that's why we don't want to bring political shows in.
But I think
we
agree on. But it's just some things we don't.
You know, something I don't like getting carried away with, like a lot of the people. I think their show is not our show. You know, political rising.
There's no reason to bring politics into
no.
this.
No. The one thing I do say is
saturated everywhere.
When are you going to legalize marijuana, you old fogies in the state capital?
And actually,
Gary's on board.
Some of the people that I know, they're said it's getting closer and closer to being legalized. But so some new group just came out with a study, I think it was yesterday, that swears that it's bad if you're a teenager. So, yeah,
well,
I know.
Well, bad, right? If you give a kid Ritalin.
You know, and that's what I want them to do the study compared to all the drugs they force kids to take and tell me which is worse.
Yeah.
You know?
You know. See, he can't do drugs. He's a good boy. He's an altar boy.
Good? Well, I know lots of altar boys that do drugs.
He goes to the confession.
Yeah, I actually have a drug test tomorrow for this state commercial driver's license.
Oh.
Yeah, they drug test all of us. So,
which, you know, I mean, when
which
you,
is good.
Yeah. If you're driving big equipment, you need to be sober.
Yeah. I mean, if you can.
And I know a guy, he had his license for like 30 years. Okay. And he did one little toke and he lost his right to drive.
That's what they do. They'll revoke it so easily. And it takes a while to get to. I mean, the training for it now and the test gets harder and harder every year.
Yeah.
But that one time that you decide to smoke or do whatever substance, and then they test you, if you get in any sort of accident, either whether it's your fault or anyone else's fault,
when the state
trooper shows up, they automatically assume it's the person with the CDL's fault, because legally, the person with the commercial driver's license, that's their job. And the person who's just driving as an operator in their car, they're just on leisure wherever they're going. They're in their free time. It might not be their job. But if you have a commercial driver's license, you are obligated to be the safest on the road.
Right, you're working.
My nephew, while people look at me, he's in Texas right now. And if you look at him and I, you would think we're father and son. That's unreal on earth. But he would tell me how he doesn't drink, he doesn't do drugs. And he would tell me how he was going down in Texas, how this car cut him off. And he would try to stop them. You just don't stop these things, I would imagine.
You can't cut them off because it takes so long
to
stop.
They're heavy.
And boy, he said the garbage that he had to go through was unbelievable. How fast were you going? What were you doing? What was on your truck? And this guy, he did get killed, unfortunately. And my nephew gave up truck driving because he said he couldn't live with the thought that he had killed someone. And I said, but it wasn't your fault. He says, I don't care. I was behind the wheel.
I know somebody who found out he had cancer, and he was such a coward that he deliberately pulled out in front of an 18-wheeler to get killed. No thought to how he destroyed that poor truck driver's life.
And he did.
He did. No, he absolutely did. And it's a shame, you know, because that truck driver did everything he could. To, you know,
as for years.
Yeah.
Right.
but he still had to live with the fact that he did it.
Right.
He got cleared, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, he wasn't. He was totally innocent. He didn't do anything wrong. I mean, you know, that's but like, it doesn't matter.
A friend of mine would tell me that the homeless, that's the suicide rate is really high.
With all veterans.
Well, yeah, I don't think it's just homeless. It's all.
With all veterans, not just a home. With all veterans.
With all veterans.
How sad.
Yeah, it is sad. It's absolutely like gut-wrenchingly sad. I mean, it's something that we wish to combat, and we're trying to develop the means to help those individuals and prevent them from that decision, because I mean, maybe some of them are absolutely dead set on it, but some of them we can still help.
But that's where another reason, and I love your program there. Because it gives them a purpose, it gives them hope, it gives them a chance.
Something to look forward to every day.
Right. Where, you know, which I think, you know, the ones that come home and don't have the support, don't have options, feel isolated, those are the ones that we need to reach out more to, which is not always easy.
Idle hands are the devil's advocate.
Right, but, you know, there's a lot of truth to that.
Yeah, it's horrible. So we do wish to bring some positivity to that. But, I mean, right now it's just laying the groundwork of it, because there's so many substantial nonprofits out there, but what I've noticed about a lot of them is they aren't led by veterans. So how can you help someone if you've never experienced it?
They don't understand.
Like, what is it? Robin Williams in Good Will Hunting, mm-hmm. with his speech about loving a woman and Michelangelo painting. You actually need to be there and see it and smell it and understand it and feel it, not just read it in a book and say that you know it. You need to absolutely go there and sign up for it and do your part with these guys,
right.
to know how they're reeling and hurting from it.
Right.
And at the same time, understand the positivity of it, because it's both sides. It's a balance. And it does take someone who's been in that community for a while now to, I believe, truly help them in the right way, because money can be thrown at any problem, but it takes
the know-how,
and the care.
Yeah. That's like I first started going to the alcohol meetings, okay? And I found that if you haven't been there, you haven't been on that road, how can you really... You have the book knowledge, but you don't have the actual compassion. But then I've also gone to counselors who are alcoholic, who are crude and rude, and because they have gotten sober, they forgot how hard it is for other people to get sober.
Right.
And they have no... You know, and they don't. There's no balance there, and you have to, like, the people we had here were really awesome.
Oh, they
you
were.
Know, he's been in order. Like, you've been on both sides of them. You've been in the military. I'm not saying you were homeless, but you've been on the side of the military. So you have this peace. You have this understanding. But you're compassionate. But you're also a no-nonsense person. Either they want your help, or they're gonna, and you're gonna bend over backwards to help them. And if they don't waste your time if they don't really want to. Does that make sense to you?
No, it absolutely does. If I pass someone on the street, I mean, as I said before, I'll give them the change, give everyone an opportunity. But if there's someone who I know and care for who comes to our community and asks for help and works every day and strives towards that positivity that they're seeking,
yeah.
then and anything you want, call me whenever. You know, but you have to be working towards it yourself, because I can't get you there. You need to get yourself there.
Right. I'll give you the tools, but I'm not going to work it for you.
I'm not you.
No.
You're yourself. You're your own individual, just as I am. You know.
This is such a good show. Don't you think?
It is, absolutely.
We're doing a lot of the psychology here, too, it's good.
You know, it just reaffirms to me my belief that, you know, days when I'm like, oh, poor me, why did all these things happen to me? But if all these things didn't happen to me, then I wouldn't understand when someone comes to me with that issue. You know, because I know people who, I have a friend who life has basically been handed to her. She had some bad things happen to her, but mostly life's been handed to her and people have done for her everything.
A lot of times those are people who think that life is so hard.
Right. But so when someone comes to her for help, she can say blah, 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 but she doesn't really know, because she's never had to deal with it. She's never had to experience it. She doesn't. And I would I would think that's the same. Like I said, I've never been a veteran, but I have a whole, you know, four of my siblings were, right, are veterans. Right. My son, my husband, my grandson, all veterans, all my uncles.
You have a grandson that's older? Seriously, you have a grandson that's
older? Yeah, he's not now, but he's 23.
Really? You don't look it.
Thank you.
Yeah. No, seriously, I didn't realize you had a child that old, grandson that old.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And, but, you know, so I would think, you know, as any, you know, as a veteran in this case, since this is what we're talking about, goes to someone for help. If they've never been a veteran, they can't relate. And that's what I love about what you're doing, you know, because you can somewhat understand what they're going through. Maybe not the exact minute details, but the overall, you have an understanding.
Yeah, it's veterans helping veterans.
Yeah, I love it.
I also, while I was taking that break, to your grandfather won many awards, didn't he? Like almost like a Purple Heart or a Bronze.
So many.
I'm sorry?
So many.
Yeah.
He never talked about it. So yeah. when he found out,
he was telling me about it.
Yeah. When. He never talked about it with my father because my father never joined, but the most my father ever heard him talk of it was trying to convince me not to join, all the stories, all the horrific, like everything. Like the worst that combat can provide you, like the two most powerful nations in the world going against each other and clashing. Like people don't realize it's not fine to find lines A and B. When there's combat and fighting of that nature, as he described, they mesh and it's all around you, it's chaos. And nothing is more violent than living amidst that chaos. It's a killing field.
Right.
So he got shot through the shoulder, and he thought he was pumped. He had the most respect for the Germans, because prior to that he'd been fighting the Italians and some very few Germans in North Africa. When they landed on Normandy, he was running across a 100-meter open field in Normandy, and he got put down from a German sniper. Running, sprinting from 200 meters away. And he said, the second that round hit me, I had the utmost respect for the Germans because I knew how hard that shot was to make. And moving forward from there, he thought he was so happy when he got shot because he thought that he was going to get sent home. But because of all of his expertise in demolition, they sent him back to England, made him better, and then told him he was going to Germany because they needed him to swim down the rivers and take the demolition off the bottoms of the bridge as the Germans are defending it up top. Because they were losing all their men, and they had no one who was trained to do it aside from him.
Because, you know, wouldn't it be, well, we've had wars since so-called God times, if you think about it. Palestine, this one's going to
get everyone's always fighting someone.
Right. I would love to see the day, I know I won't, but I'd love to see the day when everybody puts down their nuclear weapons, everybody puts down their hate weapons, everybody puts down all these weapons and start working as a community. But it's not going to happen.
No, I think you may see it in your lifetime. Now, you're a little bit older than me, so it might not be.
Well, 1 or 2 years.
It will be in, I said a little, just a little.
Okay.
I believe in the next 50 years, we will see peace because just as we've gone and now found other habitable planets, we can't be the only ones out there looking.
I'm not for a believer.
So you're saying it will take a common enemy?
Yes. To bring up.
If that does
the come world,
to fruition, we will be one team.
Right. We have to be.
We'll have to be at that point.
I mean,
even if they aren't the enemy.
Right. Right. But like movies like Independence Day, you know what they say, if it can be imagined, it's real somewhere.
You know, I have a friend of mine. Everybody thought he was psychotic. He crossed over. But I have a very good friend of mine whom everybody thought he was crazy and, you know, paranoid and all that. But everything that he has said is actually happening. Like the wars that are going on, the people who are being burned alive by acid and all this hatred and all these hate mongers and all this. And I'm like, yeah, right, you know, and all this. And you know what, Walter? My highest respect for you, because Walter gave us a lot of warnings about what was going on, but because he was so psychotic, and I don't care how many pills you gave him, see, and you know, he's still going, and you know what, everything that he has talked about is actually coming into fold.
Prophets didn't end with Jesus Christ.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, they've been throughout history. They're well documented.
See, I don't believe in schizophrenia and paranoia. I really don't. What I believe in is that a lot of the people who have this so-called paranoia and schizophrenia, they're talking to themselves, they carry on one hell of a conversation with each other, you know, themselves, and they get each other back. I truly believe that a lot of times they don't know if they should be here or if they should be on the other side. And so because they might have died a horrendous death or they might have fought to be. So when you see them talking to each other, they could also be talking to the person on the other side.
Well, just like children with imaginary friends. Yeah. You know, those kids believe that they're talking to somebody.
And they are.
So, right. I mean, you know, studies show that when they track their brain activity, they are actually talking to somebody. Yeah, whether we can see it or not. So
that's pretty crazy.
Yeah, I think that there's there is mental illness out there, in my opinion. I believe it does exist, but not everybody who's classified mentally ill is. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
We just, you know.
Well, Laura Joseph said hi.
Laura Joseph? Hi, Laura.
Yeah. She's in San Diego.
Ooh.
San Diego's nice.
One of the things I'm also looking at, and once again, we'll get out of your website, please.
Dirtveterans.com.
Okay, because it's important. I like to do this well.
Yeah, several times.
You want to read off what we got coming up?
Sure, write a big poster and put it behind me.
Well, we've had people do that, so maybe we'll
order one.
Yeah. So, just Norm wants me to remind everybody that we do have our event coming up on April 8th, so it's coming up quick, at the Unitarian Universalist Church here in Manchester. This one is to benefit the Manchester Animal Shelter. We have a ton of readers. We have a ton of vendors, more vendors every day. It's going to be a huge, huge, huge event. There will be parking at the...
Well, vendors only, though, I think. Yeah, at the church.
Right. We're going to get out.
I'm sure there will be.
So there will be more parking, you know, available around the church. No smoking outside the door. We do ask no smoking on the church grounds, at least during our event. And what was the other message we wanted to put out there? We know admission is free. We will be having a bake sale. If you want any of Mary's baked beans, you got to come early. I buy mine before the door opens because
you like baked beans?
Gone otherwise.
The hot dog, great.
Yeah, because my friend Mary, she made what, two containers?
Two big crock pots, and they were sold out within like an hour and a half.
So they must have been good.
Yeah, you got to get them early. I get them before the doors open, otherwise you don't
get any. I get them after I do a TV show with her.
She still gave me a bigger diamond. I'm sticking to that.
Oh, that's true, too.
Sorry.
Yeah. But and also, she's going to make, I think, Italian wedding soup.
Ooh, yummy.
And we're gonna be making these little finger sandwiches where you put, you know, like the tuna and the ham salad and the chicken salad, you know, like them sandwiches. It's going to be egg salad. And all these proceeds that go, like the raffle, we're going to have a raffle.
We're going to have a raffle, yeah.
And all the proceeds that is made will be going to the cause.
Manchester Animal
Manchester.
Shelter.
Yeah, the readers are getting paid 50-50. The vendors, they pay a fee, absolutely, whatever they make, they keep. So, you know, I'm not going to...
But the majority of us put that money
back
into, for the animal shelter. You know. And we do accept supplies. You know, they're always looking for towels, blankets, newspapers, cleaning supplies, copy paper... food, of course, for the animals. I mean, they're always looking for any type of supply.
And we're going to be bringing, this is something different, my friend Kate. You met Kate. She came here.
I haven't met Kate yet.
She came here. We gave her some info. You haven't met a little short, skinny girl anyway. She came. Oh, you might have been out that day.
Okay.
But she's going to get pictures, if we can work it out, and then give us pictures to put on the animals that need to be adopted.
Oh,
so
nice.
So instead of giving to the readers to have them distracted that way, we're going to make a billboard.
That's a cool idea.
That's a very cool idea.
That's a cool idea.
Yeah.
That's good.
Well, they will do it. I love doing it. But when Shelley was on, it was fantastic.
Shelley, You are amazing.
You are, and we miss you, dear. And,
I miss her.
The only reason why, to be honest with you folks, is I'm doing it now. I love the charity because it is for the animals.
Right.
You know, I'm not doing it for the staff there. I don't care less about them. I don't even like people, so I couldn't even care less. You know, but it's for the animals. That's the only reason
why. Well, we have
to
support the animals. They need our help. We have to step up and do what we can for them. And, you know, everything that...
There was a shelter out of California that, along with pictures, they also put a small description of the animal's personality outside the door, and they saw their adoption numbers go up like 30%.
What a brilliant idea. I love that.
Yeah. A little personality insert.
Yeah. That's a brilliant idea. Hear that, Manchester Animal Shelter? It's a good idea. You should do that.
One of the main reasons I'm doing it, too, because there were no kill. If Manchester was a kill, I wouldn't do it.
Right.
You know? But I think all of New Hampshire is no kill.
I think all of New Hampshire is, yeah.
Because one lady was saying Manchester was the only no kill.
I think that's the whole state. Yeah.
I think it's the whole state.
That's why we bring in animals from like Tennessee, which is a very high kill state. Yeah. I mean, we bring in animals by the plane load.
Within our miscellaneous activities also includes getting animals for the veterans.
Really?
Which is a brilliant.
Service animals or not an animal, just to have, and they'll also be able to bring them to work with them.
Our guest next week, one of the things she does is she does animal Reiki, but she does Reiki on veterans and their animals.
What is Reiki?
What's that?
I don't know what that is.
Reiki? It's a type of energy healing.
Yeah.
So what it does is it helps balance your body.
Does it?
So your body can heal itself.
Okay.
So you know how like massage manipulates your muscles? Reiki manipulates your energy.
Okay.
And cool. So she helps veterans and their animals so that they can be healthier. That's cool.
Like when I went to have my heart checked out, my heart, you know, and all this stuff, and the doctor was way off base to begin with. And I went and I had, my friend gave me Reiki energy, and everything was fine. I went and had my eyes operated on, and that worked out very successfully. It was done quicker than had I not had that Reiki. Reiki energy really helps you to relax.
Yeah.
You know, it takes a lot of energy.
It does. And then, so then your body's better, you know, functions better when you're relaxed. I mean, that's just a scientific fact. So it helps you relax. It helps balance you. It helps...
it's interesting. I've never heard of it before.
Oh, well,
Now you heard about it.
We'll get together and I'll give you a Reiki session.
And when you start this program, and we get things going the way you want, you know, your friend there would probably help your and I want to, and you, well, like maybe once a month, if we'll come in and we'll do Reiki energy on your people to help them feel better.
Yeah, we're all for whatever helps, whatever works.
Right? We're all,
absolutely.
I want to see America heal. When it's through Reiki, the Catholic Hospital would not allow them to do Reiki, and then the bishop or the Monsignor say no. But yet, they say because they don't see the Spirit. I said, do you see God? And I go, well, yeah. I go, show me where he is. Show me what he looks like. And he couldn't do it. He got upset with me that he leave his office. That's why I call it the universal spirit, because we are all in one. We're all spirit. We're all energy. Every one of us, okay? And the term God to me, and I'm not saying they're wrong. Don't get me wrong. Everybody has a right to what they want to believe in. But to me, when God is so condemning by the born again Christians, you don't follow the way they should, or God is, or whatever. It's the terminology that you're going to do it God's way, and that's the only way you're going to do it. I'm sorry, I don't agree with that. Well, you're going to do it
every
God's
way is God's way.
Yeah, so I believe if we call it the universal spirit, and like I said, this is why I say I am a spirit. I'm not gay, I'm not black, I'm not white, I'm not green, I'm not yellow, I'm a spirit in a body that is the way I am.
What is it? God gave humanity the one thing that he didn't give the angels is freedom of will.
Right. We all have free will. It's all up to us. You know, everything I do read on people, and I tell them, Everything is changeable. I have a lot of people go, oh my God, I said, you can change it. Everything that, and you tell them that too.
I do.
Everything that we do, we can change. That's the exciting part, you know. How much poor time do we have?
It's 44.
Oh, okay. Oh, we don't. Oh, that's right. Paul's not there.
Right.
She's awesome.
Oh, she's a sweetheart. Yeah.
If I was straight, she'd be a cute little lady.
Oh, honey. Please. Oh,
you know.
You say that about all the girls.
I know. Well,
you're such
you
a
know.
Dog.
I know. But one thing that I am looking at, and I have to tell you, is that this is just the beginning. You're going to have more incredible organizations that you're going to be starting.
If that's what it takes, we're more than willing to do that. I mean, we're my whole goal is just to do as much as
you.
I can. I know.
Okay, you are going to be starting. You know, like this is just the icing on the cake, the thin icing on the cake, so to speak, because you are going to be expanding to others. Like, I actually see you running a restaurant, like a diner, when training veterans, you know the veterans, whether homeless or not, having staff run in to help, you know, train them to cook so they can serve people or whatever.
I can hook you up with somebody like that.
Huh?
I can hook them up with somebody for that.
Yeah, but I actually see
today.
That happening. And I also will tell you, should you be rewarded? Absolutely, you should be financially rewarded. And you're going to be. You know, and, I mean, I'm not going to tell you you're going to make $250 million a year for your pocket, like some of the, like, kids or like that.
That's way too much.
Yeah. But I can see you're going to make it an okay limit. Because you know what? You've got to live. You know what I mean? You've got to live. You've got to be
able to. But even still, that's not the focus. Yes, it's,
no,
it's,
but I'm just saying.
Yeah, I mean, there's one focus for me right now, and it's just getting this going.
Yeah, and you are, believe me, when you get it, you're going to be amazed at how well you're going to get it going. And are you going to become impatient? Oh, absolutely. Are you going to get peed off? I don't know if I can use the other word. I'll tell you it that way. You're going to be, I've had enough. I can't take this anymore. And also, you're going to get that bump in the head, probably from your grandfather, by the way, because he really is so proud of you, and I want you to realize that. And I got to tell you, you got a lot of support that you never thought you would have in your family that's helping you. Your dad's pretty supportive, isn't he?
Yeah, he's good.
Oh, yeah, he set you up
yeah.
with the CPA.
And at one time, I remember, your mother really is supportive.
Yeah, no, I mean, they know what this idea is. They saw me work for it. So I'm fortunate to have that support. Just as far as positivity, there's no negativity, and they help when they can, how they can. But for the majority of it, I set it up, and for what I didn't know, I found my friends and those experts who did know, either consulted them or brought them into the organization. And it's nice because as far as all of us on the board, four of the five of us are outdoor-oriented, and then one is both indoor, outdoor, logistics, and outdoors. And the final one, one of the other directors on the board, is purely financial. So we have his just unbiased opinion externally. So if he sees something going the wrong way, he can see it and stop it, something that we might not be able to see, because sometimes when you're so immersed in something and you're so passionate about it, obsessed, whatever the word is you want to pin on it, whatever you want to label it as,
passionate.
You can't see.
Right.
But he's able to because he's not directly involved with operations.
Yeah.
So we're fortunate just to have this entire organization working all together.
You know what I like about what you're seeing right now, Shea, is the fact that you are not taking all the credit.
Yeah, the credit isn't just mine to take. It's all ours.
See how open that, look how many people do that, though. And you think, well, I started this organization. I started it. Or I'm sure you've heard it before by other people that what they do. That's like when I started my foundation. I want to go in the background. I don't want the credit for what's going on with it. I don't need it. I know what I'm doing. And so I can stick my chest out, even though they're not very big anymore. You know, I have to look down because they fall out on me once in a while, but you know.
In the military, they call it a spotlight ranger. A ranger is someone who's excelled in the Army. He's gone through the training. He's highly skilled. But it's transferred over a spotlight ranger where people who excel only when higher-ups are looking. So they like to shine as bright as they can whenever the spotlights are around or whenever they're in an interview. But when they go away, they're just an average schmuck. But someone who's working the entire time doesn't look as good when the spotlight's on them because they're exhausted, they're tired. So there's no need to be a spotlight ranger. And the one who's doing good the entire time is one that both higher-ups like and there's everyone who surrounds them.
I had to learn that the hard way, too.
Yeah.
My lessons have been hard. Only because I deserve them, though.
Well, yeah.
You know, I deserve to go through, you know, who the hell do you think you are? Thanks. Who the hell do you think you are? What right do you have to do this? You know, stuff like that. But I'm Norm. No, you're not. I was so scared I was going to lose my ability to do what I do. And they probably would have taken it away if I hadn't continued with the ego that I had. I mean, I wouldn't even go into the room until after everybody was sitting down. I made my big gala gay entrance, you know, my queen entrance with all that stuff in there, you know. And I was a nothing.
Thank God you stopped wearing the boa. I mean, really, it was getting annoying. Feathers everywhere.
Oh, yeah, you know.
Such drama.
Would you say the best lessons are the hardest to learn?
Yep, absolutely. If you if you haven't been there, you can't tell anybody else how to do it. Am I grateful for the lessons I've learned? Oh, absolutely. Because then, you've been through a hell and back, so to speak, right? Your lessons have not always been easy, right? You know? And it makes you appreciate what you have today.
Yeah, fully appreciative.
You know? And you saw up front what went on in the military, so you can understand that. You were a Marine, right?
Well, what's significant to me about that point is that having been there with the Marine Infantry and gone through like that deployment, it wasn't that bad personally for me. It really wasn't. But being home now and out of the military, I'm able to help someone who was the person who went through hell and had the worst time ever. So they would have been the ones to help us if God forbid we ever got ambushed.
Yeah, absolutely.
But now we're able to help them, so it's paying back in that way as well.
And see, even though you didn't go through what they went, but you still saw a lot of them, and you still are able to help them, and you're still learning from them. Any day that any person, you and I've said this so many times, any day that any person says they know it all, they know absolutely nothing. Well, Shea, I want to thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure, and I would like to have you come back on again, and we'll see you at the event on April 8th.
Unitarian Universalist Church. Come on, you got it right early.
Right off the tongue.
Don't.
But if you want to come in, at least we open up at 10 o'clock. But if you want to come in and set up a table for info, maybe have a jar there or whatever, we are more than welcome to. And I want to thank all of you people out there for watching our show. And Lori, we got, what's her name coming on?
Jennifer O'Leary Chen.
Okay.
Coming on next week.
All right. And in 2 weeks, we got Angie. And I'm so glad we made up this partner, you know. And every day, folks, I want every one of you and that tremendous camera person out there. She's beautiful. Like I said, if I was straight, oh my. But anyway,
she's telling you, still got six minutes.
Oh, that's okay. Okay. But I want to thank
every one of you. Take a commercial break.
You do what you gotta do, buddy.
Remember, every one of you, you'll always be a winner. And like, can you do a fast thing on
all right,
up here?
So,
we'll do that.
Again, at our event for readers, we are going to have Norman, myself, Colleen Costello, Jean Lejean Gray, Catherine Samuelson, Janice Donnelly, Gail Wall, Laura Joseph, Amy Major, Don Drew, Lisa Moody, Terry Milton, and Delia Bugley. And then for vendors, we have Angelina Martinez with the Bikram Yoga, Jen Walter with Phoenix and Lotus, Elaine Saunders from Dynamic Introductions, Darling Doty with her jewelry, Chris Gately doing chair massage, and again, I'm told he's amazing, so everyone should try him. Marlene Landau doing doTERRA essential oils, Danielle Fryer with Forever Aloe, Pamela Brodier with the Tibetan bowls, and Kimberly Barrett doing Says Reiki here.
And we have another guy named Kevin that's going to be selling to you. We had a donation of a doggy bed.
Oh, nice.
We're going to be raffling that
and
on.
And Bob White Bear Olson will be there with his flutes and CDs.
And we'll be doing some more of those shows, like private, you know, the Bob's
the presentations,
going to put on a presentation.
Yep, Bob will put on a
And maybe we can get
concert.
You do a little promo on stage to the people, you know, like in a private setting or when on stage. You could talk a little bit like about your, what you got planned for your...
Yeah, that sounds great. I'm perfectly comfortable with that.
Yeah. So it wasn't so bad being on here.
No, okay. It's fine. It's just a conversation.
Yeah,
right.
That's all it is.
Exactly.
That's all
it's
it is.
All it is.
And we want to thank each and every one of you for viewing our show, watching us every day. We're on just about. And remember, every day, you are the winner. We'll see you next week.